Language Diversity Ambassadors Talk. We're glad you're here. If you haven't already signed in, do so on the way out. And if you give us your email, we can send you emails about events like this that we're having in the future. The next one in our near future will be in January. We're going to have a welcome back dinner where we're going to discuss all things linguistics and more. So we're super excited to have Dr. Ben Fry here from UNC Chapel Hill. He is a citizen of the Eastern Band of Cherokee Indians. His work examines the process of language shift through the lens of urbanization, industrialization, and globalization. He is an advocate for the revitalization of indigenous languages and was a big help in our award-winning documentary, First Language, The Race to Save Cherokee. So we're excited to hear what he has in store for us, and then we will have a student panel led by Walt Wolfram, and he'll introduce those folks as we get to that. So without further ado, let's get started.
Somebody asked me to be here today and talk about languages, and so I guess that's what I'll do. But I felt it was worthwhile to examine first why one would want to do such a thing, and why one would want to talk about languages and why they're important. And I have a couple of reasons here. You know, languages connect us to our ancestors, our past, and place. They reflect the way our ancestors thought, lifestyle, values encoded in language, and it's a salient marker of identity. So it marks who we are and who we are not. So it can tell us a lot about members of our own groups and members of other groups and people who maybe we don't want to associate with, et cetera, and so forth. But I think perhaps the most important reason for putting that last one on there is because a lot of people will say, well, we need to preserve languages for science or for the general human need or for the general human endeavor. And that's true, but the fact that a lot of native languages are disappearing today is not by happenstance. Even the language that people use to talk about them, like disappearing, they're not just sort of magically vanishing. They were actively extinguished. And because these things are social injustices, that has to also be recognized. You know, you have to talk about the fact that language is unique to who a person is and the leader of that culture. And if you take that away, that's I'm not going to hedge. It's a form of genocide. Epistemic violence, cultural genocide, and this kind of thing. And so that's why it's very important to consider language, not just as far as like what it can do for all of us, but what has been done to individual people and what has been done to individual cultures. And so I thought that was very important to note. But to talk about the native languages of North Carolina, and I'll also do a little bit about the dialect of North Carolina, I thought we'd start out with some maps. You get a little bit more granular depending on which map you go with. You have Cherokee out in the western part of the state, some Creek and Muskogean presence right next to it, and there's a wide swath of Catawba and Carolina Sioux on. So North Carolina was really a crossroads of lots of different kind of languages throughout history, and I think that's what makes this region so interesting. Is I think I heard somebody say a linguist heaven or something like that. I can't remember who or what it was, but you know, you really have that in all kinds of senses, because you have it with the English dialects that you end up getting later on, and you even had it already before European contact. So you have Siouan languages related to the Lakota, Dakota, Nakota out in the Great Plains. You have Cherokee, the one lone Iroquoian language, hanging out there in the Appalachians, apart from the Iroquoian languages of the Great Lakes, like Seneca, Cayuga, Onondaga, Mohawk, Tuscarora, you also have here. But Tuscarora, linguistically, hangs out a lot closer to the northern folks, has a lot more in common with them than does Cherokee. So Cherokee is supposed to be the only surviving member of the southern Iroquoian family. And then you got, you know, various other kinds of Siouan languages, and along the coast you would have had some kind of Carolina Algonquin going on here. So along the coast you would have gone up to Virginia, you would have been talking about Powhatans, and the story of Squanto that everybody knows so well for Thanksgiving and stuff like that. That's where those people were along that coast, and so that would have extended down. And I wanted to talk a little bit about the geographical sense here. Because you do get this crossroads, you can't really think about these people having been stationary. So you get lots of interaction between people as they're trading. Archaeologically speaking, we know that they were trading with one another. We know they were talking to each other. And a lot of these people have related languages. So what that tends to mean, in some cases, is you get what's called a dialect continuum. And it doesn't mean necessarily that one language is mutually intelligible with another language, but you might get something where D1 and D2 can talk to each other pretty well, but D1 can't talk to D3, or perhaps more extreme, D3 can talk to D4, but you know, D1 and D4, forget it. So that's your sort of spectrum that you get, where you can talk about the differences between dialects and languages. Two people might be declared to be speaking different languages, but actually they understand each other pretty well. It just happens to be that they can do that because they come from neighboring towns. So within language families, that might have been the case. So Muscogean languages, a lot of them probably like that. Siouan languages, same thing. Not so much with Cherokee and, say, Cree, necessarily, because they're from different language families and they would have been unintelligible to each other. Although, it's likely that there were people who spoke both. You also would have had lingua francas. So you would have had trade languages that would be used to communicate generally between villages. And so if you were going to a town out in the eastern part of the state, you wouldn't necessarily speak every Siouan language of every village that you go to, but you could use Chulo, for example, and you'd be able to talk to everybody. Or if you're going toward the southwest of the state, you might be able to pick up a little bit of Creek, and you run into several different Muscogean-speaking villages, and you get along pretty well in Creek. Go to the coast, and of course then you're going to be speaking Mobilian trade jargon, which is based on Choctaw from further out west. So those languages of wider use get you different kinds of mileage depending on what geographical region you're in. And there were a couple, you know, because people needed to talk to each other over, you know, great distances. So topographical divisions. North Carolina is extremely interesting because of the multiple geographical regions and topographical regions we have. I like this picture of the Appalachian Ridge quite a bit because people talk about Cherokee dialects in terms of overhill, underhill, and middle dialects. So right on the ridge here, you would have the middle dialect of Cherokee. To the north of it, you would have the overhill dialects. To the south of it, you'd the underhill dialects for obvious reasons, right? And then once you get into Piedmont, that's not only a different geographical, topographical area, but it's also different landscape, linguistically speaking. You got different people speaking different language there. You got some different cultural tropes. You got some different kinds of activities as far as subsistence, hunting and gathering. You got different styles of agriculture going on in these different ways. And the coast, once again, you know, you have different lifestyles with fishing and probably mussel collection, shellfish, and things like that. And the other thing, different developments and differentiation. One thing you got to remember, I'm not sure how linguistic-y everybody is in here, but one thing that really is important for language differentiation is when you have isolation and people aren't talking to each other very much, you can evolve a new language in that way. So languages become different depending on how long you're isolated from one another. So you get a language like Cherokee that hasn't hung out with its relatives in the north for 4,000 years, and it really gets quite different from the northern Iroquoian languages, but in some ways it can be eerily similar to the ones that are right around it, even though it's not in the same family. So archaeologists split this time period into several different eras. I want to talk mostly about the woodland and Mississippian eras, mostly because it's interesting to the subsistence and to what you can sort of see about the history of the region. During the woodland period, you had a lot of hunting and gathering, subsistence level agriculture, decisions being made by consensus, headmen being chosen by consensus. So it wasn't so much a hierarchical structure. You wouldn't have had somebody who was the principal chief and their authority couldn't be questioned and everybody else was subservient to them. You had an egalitarian society where you just followed somebody who was capable of leading. Leading, not leaving.
What a slip.
Okay, so somebody would have led by consensus. As long as people felt that that person was a good leader, they would be the leader. And when they no longer felt that way, they wouldn't be the leader anymore. And you had a preponderance of burial mounds in a lot of these woodlands settlements. And the reason I mention a lot of this is because you can see some of these same tropes in Cherokee culture today. So egalitarian nature of the society, anti-hierarchy, decision-making by consensus, leaders leading by consensus, and you ask Cherokee people who built the mounds, what are they there for? People will either say, we don't know, they'll say, we built them, or they'll lie to you in some kind of way because they, you know, it's not for you to know. So the mounds are mixed in some ways. Like you get some burial mounds, some temple mounds, I think. The Mississippian period, so that shows a lot of influence from Cahokia. I don't know how much people know about Cahokia, but Cahokia was a big metropolitan indigenous town on the banks of the Mississippi River, right outside St. Louis. So Cahokia is the place where you begin getting these large temple mounds, you get a hierarchical society, and you get mass cultivation of corn. So maize becomes king in this era. You get, if you read Tim Popcat's book on Cahokia, he talks about mortuary theater that's done in this era. So you have comely young women coming from the peripheral villages and being sacrificed on the temple mound to ensure a good harvest of the corn. Needless to say, people aren't really quite fond of this. They don't like that so much, you know. So, but somehow it still proliferates. So you have a Mississippian wave that sweeps across the southeast, and you have this system whereby you have principal chiefdoms, you have a paramount chief, and you have tribute towns on the outliers. So on the fringes, you have people that are sending in game and sources of protein, textiles, and things like that, and they're paying tribute to the center. That begins spreading out to the east from the Mississippi, and you see towns like this popping up all along the southeast, right around until it gets to the Appalachian Ridge. So here's Cahokia. It rises in about 1050, it falls in about 1350. People say that around the same time it was contemporary with London, so it was about the same size, and it was about, you know, the same kind of population. This was a massive city on a global scale. Not frequently talked about, mostly because it seems to have fallen before European contact even occurred. This is basically what the Spaniards find, this kind of Mississippian world, or at least the remnants of it, when they come to the southeast on expeditions. You have Hernando de Soto in the 1540s and Juan Pardo in the 1560s, and they make this expedition all throughout the southeast. They come upon lots of different chiefdoms. Most people in this region are probably Muscovian speaking. And so there's a story about the cacique, what they call the cacique of Kofidjeki, this town right here. So they pick up this woman who is probably a principal chief, and they bring her around and they use her as an interpreter. And she speaks whatever trade language or Muscovian language is being spoken in those villages or whatever she's fluent in. And you know, people understand her. They understand that the Spaniards are here. They're trying to find gold. They're torturing people or killing people or raping them, and you know, all these things. So she's able to tell them about all that's going to happen. Until they get to about this area here, until they get around Coosa, primarily in the Appalachians, and they encounter these people they call Chilokin or Chiluki. Possibly Chiluk B. and different Muskogean languages, that gets interpreted as either people who speak a different language or people who live in caves. The modern word in Cherokee for Cherokee is Jalagin, but it's generally thought that that was somebody else's name for us rather than what we called ourselves, as is usually the case. With a lot of tribes, you'll find that what people called them is not what they called themselves, and the name they got stuck with today is usually the thing that somebody else called them in the past. So we actually called ourselves Anigaduwagin, because we're people of Gadua. The town of Gadua is located about 15 minutes outside of Bryson City, North Carolina, and it's been continuously occupied for something like 14,000 years. So anyway, one of my big tip-offs is they couldn't understand the Cacique of Kofi Tu Cheki when she came in and began speaking this, because these were people of another language. And I'm thinking, who are the major people speaking a different language around that area, around that time? So I think that that was Cherokee. It could not have been, yeah.
So Cacique, was that just like a title for a chief or something?
Yeah, so I think they took that from the Taino, actually, in the islands. That was a title they picked up from other indigenous people.
And, okay.
Yeah, so they were referring to her as that.
I don't know, I'm just wondering, because I know in Honduras, we call the chief cacique, which is very similar to that, of course.
Yeah.
So it's like, oh, this is pretty cool.
I'm pretty sure that's where they picked it up from,
yeah.
Was that area. That
area, yeah.
The Spaniards come and they encounter a bunch of paramount chiefdoms, they encounter a bunch of tribute towns, they encounter a bunch of mounds and fairly well-off people. And then the English get there and the world is completely different. So the English get there and when they do, they find the landscape largely empty. They find towns that have essentially been ruined, that have been decimated, and the general consensus is that this is the era when plagues hit. Populations declined on the order of something like 90%. So this was a post-apocalyptic time, effectively. I don't know if anybody watches The Walking Dead, but think about Judith, the baby that grows up in this post-zombie world, and she's born then. That's what a lot of people are being born into, like, around this time. So what you have happening in a lot of these places is people recombining, because if your village is wiped out and you're one of, you know, three people that survived out of 100, then the best thing for you to do is go to the nearest neighboring village that you know of, even if they were your former enemies, and say, did any of you guys survive? So they, you know, bond together and make new confederations. So you get coalitions happening, and that's actually where you get the Creek Nation. Today, the Creek Nation is made up of multiple different kinds of people, and you even have a lot of that happening among other nations, like the Catawba. Who are Siouan speakers, once again, you know, they begin absorbing other Siouan-speaking tribes. Don't quote me on this, but I believe perhaps the Siponis, the Okanichis, and those types of people. So you get some of these configuring themselves into new nations and sort of taking on new identities, because this becomes necessary in this time period. That's what they have to do. So the other thing you get, of course, is internecine warfare. You get tribes fighting amongst one another, because a lot of people have taken the tack of replenishing their populations by taking slaves from other people. So one of the ways that you can go and replenish your population is you can go and just snatch people from other villages. And you have that happening among the Yamasees, you have it happening among the nascent Iroquois nations, the Haudenosaunee Confederacy. They're doing a little bit of that. They're going slave raiding and stuff like that. And a lot of these people are doing it basically because the world has ended. You know, it's like Mad Max or something, if I'm going to use another movie reference. People are just riding around in this desert on motorcycles. No motorcycles. But imagine that, right? That's your setting. So, and that's kind of what the English encounter when they come. And of course, the English, when they come in, are saying, God has blessed us with this open land where no one is here. And somehow it is perfectly curated for our comfort and well-being. It is a magical place designed for us by God. You know, well, you know, kind of. So you get Roanoke established in 1585, abandoned somewhere along the 1590s, and one of the interesting theories, I'm not going to say it's the theory, but one of the theories is that the settlers from this colony might have integrated with the local native people. And there's a lot of people who have claimed this. The Lumbee, the Croatan, Saponia Person County, Catawba. And it's really hard to tell. It's hard to tell exactly where these people went and exactly what happened to them. But I really think if I had to say anything, my money's on, yeah, they didn't know what they were doing, so they went to the people that had been living there for a couple of thousand years who probably did know what they were doing, at least more or less, you know. So then that colony is abandoned. You think Jamestown settled in 1607 in Virginia, and then the English are sort of off to the races, and, you know, colonial history as we know it sort of begins. But one of the interesting things I wanted to talk about is the fact that the English landscape, linguistically, socially, culturally, differed so much from the one the Spaniards had encountered, and how the world is effectively reconfigured because of the plagues and the population decimation that then continued to have effects just among the native people themselves because of the intertribal warfare, the slaving, the population replenishment, and so on. Yeah.
So when did this happen, like in a period of like 50 to 75 years, like when the Soto showed up to when the Kimarona?
Something like that, yeah. So, you know, it seems quick on a long scale, but 75 years, you know, you've got to think that's... So, yeah, World War II, something like that. So that's a pretty great swath of history for these people. To talk about the particular languages of North Carolina, I just put a bunch of them up here. You got Tuscarora. I kind of lined up the Iroquoian ones up front. And what's fascinating to me is that you don't really get a lot of similarity in many ways between Cherokee and Tuscarora, because you got Southern Iroquoian and Cherokee, Northern Iroquoian, and Tuscarora, Echi, Necti, Ase, Shogun, Tatli, Zoin, in Cherokee. You do get Rekwe in Tuscarora, and then Yanawi in Cherokee. So that's maybe related, but Yanawi is person. I believe in Mohawk it's Ongwe for man, and Askaya for man in Cherokee today. Akeekwe in Tuscarora, and then Akeekya, so Akeekya. That's some of your related basic vocabulary. Geesh, probably geesh, you know, geeshly in Cherokee. Hikde, Nadong, Ikad, Awe. Awe, maybe the only one maybe would have been the Underhill dialect form, Awa. So you can see the distance between those. And then the other thing I found really interesting about this is Cherokee has this word Nadong. For sun, it actually means any celestial body. So you could refer to the sun this way or the moon. So Nadong Iga Ehi is the celestial body that lives during the day. Nadong Ushahi Ehi would be the one that lives at night. And so Nadong Ushahi Ehi, and then sun in Catawba, Nadin. Nadin. Nadong. Okay, so. Siouan language, genetically unrelated to Cherokee, but somehow the words are remarkably similar. So that's probably borrowing, probably long word. And I kind of wanted to put these up mostly just to showcase the differences between the languages in general.
People like data.
So today, I can't really talk a whole lot about the different circumstances of all these languages, but I can tell you what the situation is for Cherokee. There's about 200 to 250 speakers of Eastern Cherokee, and here are their names. So these people are mostly over 60 years old. The ones that are crossed out in red have died. So from the time the list was made to, you know, now we've lost several people that are on this list, and it keeps counting down. There's about 6,000 speakers in Oklahoma. Revitalization is underway in both nations, both Cherokee, well, the Eastern Band of Cherokee Indians and the Cherokee Nation, which is out in Oklahoma, have language immersion schools where they start the kids as infants and they speak Cherokee to them 8 hours a day, 5 days a week. You guys probably know all this because of the film. But they then begin schooling in Cherokee. And I hate to say it, but Nuvadua Academy in North Carolina has begun cutting them down to an hour and 15 minutes of Cherokee a day, starting in fourth grade or so. This is tremendously distressing to me personally, because I'm thinking, well, how are they going to become fluent speakers if you're only giving them an hour and 15 minutes a day? That's like a Spanish class at a typical high school. Maybe a little bit more, but not a whole lot. So the plan was that they would become first language speakers, that they would acquire it as a first language and they would become fluent throughout the course of their lives. That has sort of happened, kind of, but a lot of the kids are learning it more as a second language than as a first one, and they do a lot of overgeneralizing of things like the imperative, like, because that's what they hear a lot, right? Like, sit down, wash your hands, don't touch him, leave that alone. So that's a lot of the language that they're producing. One of the big worries is when they get into the English-speaking school after sixth grade, in both nations, actually, in Cherokee Nation and in the Eastern Band, is what's going to happen to them, what's going to happen to their Cherokee. And the parents are also worried about, are they going to read at grade level? So that's where this pressure has come from, to put more and more English into the school, because the parents want them to be prepared. They don't want them to look stupid when they come to the English-speaking school. So they're saying, give them more English, give them more English, give them more English. And unfortunately, it comes at the expense of Cherokee. To my knowledge, there are not very many speakers of other indigenous languages in North Carolina, except for, of course, you know, the Lumbees, the largest group east of the Mississippi. Plenty of Lumbee English speakers, which I'm going to talk about in just a second. I guess I'll go ahead and get to it. You know, new varieties are continuing to flourish. So you do have Lumbee English. And it's a unique variety of English spoken by the Lumbee Nation, Robson County, and of course, everywhere else too, you know, like Lumbees are all over the place. I know, everywhere. The vocabulary and pronunciation are different in systematic ways from other southern dialects. I think you guys were just discussing this over here about I weren't rather than I wasn't. Yep, you don't hear that in many other southern dialects. It's particular, you know. And some aspects may trace back to any of the several languages Lumbee ancestors might have spoken. And once again, this goes back to the crossroads idea about North Carolina having been a crossroads of several different languages and language families, because you would have had several different languages interacting in that region. And so there likely would have been some kind of a lingua franca spoken among those people, and several different inputs going into what eventually would become Lumbee English today. So ongoing revitalization efforts. Marty Richardson works at the North Carolina Folklife Institute. He's been working on Tutelo revitalization. Tutelo was one of the Siouan languages that was spoken as a trade language. In the sort of central region. You also have Catawba being revitalized by the Catawba Nation in South Carolina, and the Nuvadua Academy is undergoing some revitalization work in Cherokee, North Carolina, about an hour west of Asheville. I am currently teaching Cherokee first semester and third semester at UNC Chapel Hill. I don't know. Personally, I kind of think it's important. I don't know. It's a good idea to do. Because what's going to happen is, like I said, our speakers are over 60 for the most part, and our kids are around 10, 12. So there's going to be a time when the speakers are going to pass away. You know, there's going to be that time. And if the kids don't see the language spoken in day-to-day context, if they don't see it normalized and spoken as a real language, they're going to drop it, because they're already, I mean, sixth graders are smart. I mean, you know, they can take social cues like a boss. If they see something's not useful, they chuck it. You know, they're sort of mercilessly realistic as far as what they pick up on linguistically. So my hope is to train a lot of second language speakers with Cherokee and send them into the schools, take it over from the inside. I'd like to be able to get a lot more second language speakers trained and using the language on a day-to-day basis so that the kids will have some kind of role models so that maybe they'll be able to bridge that gap between the kids and the older generation. So that's what I have. Shaquini.
Do you want to start right with the panel, or do you have a question or two for him? Yeah, we'll ask
him. I just want to know about the difference between Eastern Band and Cherokee Nation languages. Is it completely mutually intelligible?
Oh, yeah. Well, they'll tell you it's not. People like to complain around about that, like they can't understand each other, or tell each other they're saying it wrong. Put food in front of them and wait 15 minutes, and they're all laughing together and stuff.
And so is there some systematic work together over the language?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, they've worked together. So quite a bit in the last decade. They have language consortia, and they have times where they'll bring the speakers from both nations together, and they'll sign on new words that they're going to translate and give to the schools. And it's mutually intelligible. They just like to grouse around.
I'm sure there's some differences.
There are differences.
But that's good.
Just one quick question before we transition to the students. Do they still have Cherokee available for all of the university students around the state?
Yeah, it'll fulfill your foreign language credit in North Carolina.
Yeah, but you can take it through the consortium, right, and take it on campus? Do they have that anymore?
You can take it on campus at UNC, you can take it at Western Carolina University. And I think
students
you can
at
take
other universities take it?
Yeah.
Teleconferencing or something?
Yeah, well, I think they still do the teleconferencing. I know that Western has an online class.
Right.
So you can take it that way through Western Carolina University. And I actually have a student from Duke that's in one of my classes, so that will work if you happen to want to take it on campus at UNC also.
I don't
appreciate it.
So you said there are revitalization of the languages in the Eastern Band and the Cherokee Nation. What about the other plan of
United
the
United Bands?
I don't
really know
about
them either.
Yeah.
I think their blood quantum is 1/4 or higher, and so they're sort of one of the most culturally conservative groups, and I think they have the highest percentage of their population that are already speakers of Cherokee, so it's possible they're not even worried about it. You know, they've got a lot of speakers in the United Two Bands. So
is that language, it's all Cherokee, or is it just different dialects of Cherokee?
So the UKB and the Cherokee Nation mostly speak the Overhill dialect, or several varieties of the Overhill dialect, and people in North Carolina speak the Middle dialect and a North Carolina version of the Overhill dialect that is still here.
Okay.
Yeah.
I don't know about
others. I have two quick questions.
Oh.
There's time. Is there time?
Well, for you.
I was just wondering about the Catawba and Tutelo languages. Like, are there currently native speakers, or are they trying to
I think they're trying to revive them.
Reviving.
Yeah,
okay.
They're reviving them.
And my second was, is Lumbee the only English variety that, or did you sort of mention that there's varieties and I wasn't sure what?
Yeah, I'm going to have to kind of plead ignorance and defer on that one. You probably have a lot more information about that than I do.
There are different varieties. Actually, our research suggests that as far as, although some people maintain there isn't really a pan-lectal American Indian variety, although some people claim it because of boarding schools and so forth, there may be some shared traits. But actually, for example, the Lumbee English, which we have studied, is a very localized kind of variety. So speakers from Robeson County certainly know a Lumbee when they hear one. But white people from other places think that they're just Southern and maybe a little a little differently Southern, but essentially Southern. So it's a very localized kind of identity. So that brings us to our panel. All right, and thanks, first of all, for taking the time to come with us. So we have Alexis Frakes, who's from Europe.
You're Alexis.
Oh, I knew one of your women was Alexis.
We're not in order.
Okay. Who is a sophomore in technology, engineering, design, education, and she's a native Hawaiian and is from Jacksonville, North Carolina. So thanks for coming. And then we have Megan Jones, all right, who has a Bachelor of Science degree in Environmental Engineering, and will earn her Master's degree in Environmental Engineering this December, right? So you're gonna have to face the world. All right, and she is a Lumbee, and is from Prospect, North Carolina. For those of you who know anything about Robinson County, Prospect is always is often considered the sort of cultural heart of Lumbee, all right? And then another Lumbee from Prospect, right? Yeah, as a freshman majoring in economics, all right? So, and you're just in your first year, so thanks for coming. And then our last member of the panel is Roberta Richardson. If you know anything about names and associations with identities, you know that she's a Haluasa Pony. All right, there are many Richardsons. All right, and she's majoring in animal science. She likes big animals, not small ones. So she should like me. And she's planning to go to a veterinary school in 2017, and I can tell from personal experience there's a lot of money in veterinary medicine. Those of you who have animals who need their attention. So thanks. And she's from Roanoke Rapids, and her parents are from the Hollister area. I'm sorry, Belton. Dude. Okay, so actually, we're going to just sort of let you talk a little about your experiences. I'll ask you a couple of questions, but I really want you to sort of take the discussion where you wanted to go. So how do you feel that your language distinguishes you? And most of you are sort of like speakers of varieties of English without sort of an ancestral language that you speak, and how do you feel about that?
Okay, let's go this way. There's a lot to talk about with Lumbee English, and like he said, people will think that I'm Southern, but some people think I'm from a different country, like that are not from North Carolina and don't understand Southern slang. But like he said, when you hear another Lumbee talk, you can tell that they're Lumbee and that they're from Robinson County. And I grew up with my mother, she's white, and she's actually Scots Irish, and she has she does not have the dialect that I'm speaking, like she doesn't have the accent, and we're from the exact same place. So I'm not sure like how that happens, but it's very unique, and I find pride in the way we talk, even though some people think that we sound stupid or they downplay us because we have such a weird accent or something. But I don't know really where to start, but just the fact that our accents and our dialect and our slang brings us together as a community, because in Robinson County, a third of the population is Native American, a third of the population is Black, and a third of the population is Hispanic, or white. And then the rest of are the other races. So it's mainly like a mixture of people, but then the Lumbee people have their own Lumbee English. So just find it a sense of pride in our community.
Okay. Well, we'll let the others speak, and then you can follow up, and I'll let other people. Okay, Roberta, how about you? Okay.
So like you said, I'm from Rock Rapids, and so I don't think that I talk about the people in Hollister, but the people in Hollister definitely have an accent. Like anybody that grew up in Hollister sounds different to me, and people claim that my parents have an accent, but I don't hear it anymore. But we don't have it as like people don't recognize it as distinct as Lumbee English. But if I hear somebody from Hollister, I'm gonna know they're from Hollister. And then, like, as far as he was saying with my last name, like, if you see somebody, and for instance, okay, there's a church name called Mount Bethlehem Hollister, and everybody in there is gonna know you somehow from your parents. Anybody say your name, they're gonna know you somehow. Just say your mom and daddy's name, they'll know you. But so I think that they have an accent, but I'm not sure how much I have it, and it's definitely, I don't know, something unique, and I like hearing people from Hollister because it makes me feel like I'm at home, so I'm proud of it. I don't mind it at all, but.
That's so good. Megan?
Oh, I'm like Alexa. So I did grow up in Jacksonville, North Carolina, which, if some of you don't know, is a large military town. So I really don't have an accent. I personally don't. My dad's European and my mom's Native Hawaiian. Her family like cultivated that and everything. So we're considered indigenous. So my mom's from Hilo, Hawaii and everything. And she has what they call Pidgin English, which is, Pidgin is a type of dialect, and it's like broken English in a kind of way. So, and that comes out more when she's mad, excited, trying to explain something to us. So growing up, it was really hard, like, trying to figure out what she was saying. Like, they take out, like, the noun, the verb, and the adjective of the sentence. It sounds crazy, but, like, she told me, go take that, put that over there, and put it up there. Didn't point at anything, and I had to know, like, take the tablecloth, put it in a bag, put it in a box, and put it on top of the shelf in the garage. Like, you're supposed to know that, growing up and everything. We do have a Hawaiian language, but, sadly, I wasn't able to learn it because I did live and grow up in North Carolina, and that was unbeknownst to me. So I just grew up listening to Pidgin English. A lot of our cousins live in Jacksonville too, so when they're all together, it all comes out. We have to like understand them because I do have a very Americanized vocabulary compared to their slang.
Okay, so how does your mom feel about her Pidgin?
Oh, she doesn't recognize it. And so she does not think she has an accent or anything. And like she doesn't really pick up on like typical words or that like conjunction. She doesn't recognize that. So she doesn't say pronounce or enunciate. She says pronunciate. And she says recognize. And like we point that out to her and she goes, oh, I'm just covering the basics. Like, okay.
She talks really fast.
Yes, that's another thing. She talks like so fast and we're like, you have to slow down, like people can't keep up with that and everything. And that's just really normal to us. And a lot of people don't recognize that there's Hawaiian Pidgin English and then just English in Hawaii and everything.
So Belton, this is your first year here, right? And I presume you went to Sweat High School.
School of Science and Math for the last 2 years. So.
So you left Robeson County in Prospect and went to the School of Science and Math. What was your reaction to that language, and what was the reaction to you? What was the reaction to your language, and how did you feel about that?
Yeah, it was crazy. So that was like, for those of you who don't know, it's over in Durham, and it's for like your junior, senior year of high school. So I was like 15 when I went, and like Pernell Sweat High School is like 85% Native, like right under my house and everything. So like there I was always like part of the majority and stuff. But then Science and Math, there were like 5 of us, I guess, and that's the most they've ever had in like recent history. So I don't know, like I didn't like have a problem with the way they talked and stuff because like it sounded normal to me. But a lot of people did have a problem with the way I talked. Like they said they couldn't understand me and stuff. And then some people, I guess, like, if you know anything about Durham, like, they have their own kind of thing going on there. And then all these people from, like, all over the state who've, like, moved from all over the country. And we had, like, students who had recently, like, immigrated to the U.S. So, like, a lot of different things coming together. And it, like, just, like, a weird, I don't know, weird standardization, I guess. But, like, sometimes, like, people just pointed out and laughed about it and stuff. And, like, that was fine with me. But sometimes they would say, like, why can't you just, like, say it the right way or something like that and stuff. So I kind of found myself like starting to speak differently. I don't know.
Yeah, you do speak a little bit differently from YouTube, for example.
Yeah, so
and do you find that offensive when people tell you those things?
Yeah, I did find it really offensive because, like, growing up, I think it's, like, actually your project. Like, we had a section in class where they talked about how Lumbee English, and it was, like, important and stuff and, like, very unique. So I was really proud of
so
it.
So you did that in class?
Yeah, in 8th grade. We, like, watched the videos and everything. But, so I was, like, really proud of it. And people, like, would think, oh, you're just, like, really Southern. And I would try and tell them, like, no, this is, like, really cool and unique and stuff, just us. And they didn't really, like, care, I guess. So that was kind of offensive. And then when I started speaking differently, I would go back home, and then people don't really recognize. Like, I was getting a haircut in Lumberton, like, 2 minutes from my house. And this guy who was native, the barber, he was like, where are you from and stuff? I was like, oh, I'm from Prospect. He was like, really? You don't sound like anybody from Prospect I've ever known. And so, lived there my whole life. Like,
So then you're kind of caught between worlds?
Yeah, and it's like more of a thing, like, for me, it was like, since I'm, I guess, lighter, like, maybe not lighter, so like, you can't really look at us and tell, like, instantly that we're Lumbee. So it was like, that's another piece that, like, is missing. So it's like, there's only a few more things left, I guess.
So let me ask you a question, and then I'll turn it over to them. So, you know, in the 1956 Congressional Act that recognized Lumbee without any entitlements, there's a phrase that says they're unique by appearance and manner of talk, which they're talking about the Lumbee. And so one of the questions that I've had sort of since I've studied this stuff is, how come the unique dialect is not a part of sort of the petition to be recognized fully? Because, I mean, as I say to my students, it's not like people have got together in a longhouse and said, let's talk different. And you know, it just sort of happened and becomes a token of sort of cultural uniqueness. Don't you think that should be a sort of component of sort of recognizing the Lumbee as a unique tribe?
I think so, but other tribes don't think so. And a lot of other people don't think that we are, they're just like, y'all are just a bunch of mixed breeds. Like, that's all I've ever heard my whole life. And I'm like, you've never been to Pembroke, you've never been to Prospect, you don't know how we live. Like, if you visit that area and then you go visit a reservation, it's very, very, very similar. And like, I've even had that experience because the community is set up the same way. The people, the family relations are set up the same way. And just because we can't trace our one language back, because it's a conglomeration of different languages. It's not just, I mean, if you know where Robson County is, it's surrounded by swamp area. And I'm sure the people that went there settled there because it was a swamp area and they were very isolated. And so whoever those people were, and they come together and this language produces, but then they were forced to speak English. Well, I mean, what comes out of that? But there's the people are still there. The dialect is still there. So I don't understand why it's not unique. And I think it should be considered. But there's so many other factors. With federal recognition, and honestly, I'm not one of those people that think we need federal recognition because it's money, and I don't need the United States to tell me that I'm Lumbee. I don't think that, but maybe some people in our tribe do.
Which is another thing that sort of, you know, one of the things that people say, that sort of the identification is people from the outside are always trying to define them. And sort of like, why do we need them to define us? Sort of, we know who we are, which is one of the things that we so often heard in interviews with people. You know, like, we know who we are. Why do we need outsiders to sort of verify our Indianness if we know who we are? So.
Yeah, I guess, I mean, there's monetary benefits that come with that. But the way people are, there's crooked people in the world, there's crooked people in tribal councils.
No.
Who knows what would happen with the money that were the benefits that we got from the United States.
Let's open it up to the rest of the audience. I have sort of lots and lots of questions and lots of fascinating intrigue, but we'll open it up to others in the audience who might have questions for y'all or for Ben.
Are there any social network options with people in Cherokee Mountains? Social networking with this? Is this like a integration where people can find their relatives, possible relatives?
I'm not sure I understand the question.
I was just curious to know how people can, if someone knows that they have Cherokee ancestors from a certain area, how would they go about research?
For the Eastern Band, the requirement for membership is you have to be 1/16th blood quantum or higher, and you have to be able to trace your ancestry to somebody that was on the Baker roll in 1924. So you have to know the name of the ancestor, and you have to be able to locate it on the Baker roll. Yeah. And for the Cherokee Nation, there's no blood quantum requirement, and you have to trace the ancestry back to the Dawes roll in 1938.
Hello, my name is Frankie Gilmore. I'm Navajo from Four Corners area, a place called Xochimilco. And I'm quite interested in what you were discussing, simply because it's a lot different for me over there, because, you know, we still have close to 70% that speak fluent Navajo. And so everywhere I go over there, I hear it all the time. That's my first language. But what I'm hearing, as I kind of came in late, but what I heard was that, by the way, I'm very interested in other tribes, because I taught Navajo language for 7 years and more. But I'm very interested in the next generation. And what I'm hearing is that, based upon your accent, that's how you separate yourselves from one band to the other. That's how I understand it. Am I hearing it wrong or what?
It's not just dialect, it's not just accents. Like, there's so many different slang words that are particular to Lumbee people that like no one else in this world would understand. Like, my grandma still says stuff and I'm just like, what are you talking about? Because it's the accent, but it's also words that are just kind of like broken English, like Alexa said. And that's for the Lumbee, but I don't know about for like the Haudo Saponi tribe or Okanichi or Saponi, like none of them speak their languages either, because I'm not sure about like how they actually go about identifying each other either. But with Lumbees, I feel like the only way that you can really understand it is if you go visit your birth.
So based on the English that you speak, that's how you differentiate.
Yeah.
Let's say, are you saying like between like linguistically or just like people?
There is no Lumbee language. Like, for example, Navajo, there is a specific language, but we do have Western, and then we have Eastern Navajo,
mm-hmm.
and the language does change in somewhat. But this is just what I'm hearing from y'all.
Well, we have, like within, we were talking about within just like, so there's 60,000 Lumbee, so the most of us are in Robeson County. So in Prospect, where we're from, like there's a specific like subset, and then you go to like Saddle Tree outside of Lumberton, there's a different, like, so that's that. But like, identifying like other Lumbees, it's not just language for us, it's like your name, where you come from and stuff, like certain mannerisms, and it's just like a lot of, like, for the whole picture, I guess, not just looking at language. Because like, I know some analogy people, like, or not analogy, but stories people use, is like you see someone, you think, oh, that's a Lumbee, and then you just gotta hear them talk, and that's like putting the seal on the envelope or something, and like putting the icing on the cake.
Other questions? And how do you feel about your variety compared to, say, for example, Colombian English, the Alawasa Kori? I mean, do you feel a sort of sense of pride as well? Or?
Yeah, I think I hate that, like, I don't sound like people, like my parents or somebody that grew up in Hollister, but it I don't feel like, well, some people say I do, but I don't feel like I do. But,
well, let's put it this way, kid, you don't sound like you're from Raleigh.
Yeah, see, Justin, so, sorry, that's my cousin, but he works at the university, but I don't know, they just sound different, and I recognize it, and it's good to, like, hear it, just because I'm like, hey, I know where you're from, like, you're probably family, maybe, and it just makes you feel at home, I guess, and especially, like, my freshman year coming up here, Raleigh is so much different. My freshman year, my first semester, like, I went home every single weekend, without a doubt. And going home is just home. Like, going to Hollister, I grew up in Rock Rapids, so pretty much anybody at high school thought that I was mixed, Mexican, one of the two. But then when I went to Hollister, everybody saw me and they knew, hey, she's Native American. Knew my mom and daddy, knew my grandpa, my great-grandpa, everything. So Hollister's just, it's not where I grew up at, but it's where I know everybody knows that I'm me, kind of. So I'm proud of it, and I like it.
we have this new video app, because we do a lot of stuff on language diversity, and we need you kids to do it, even though we've had it. And how does it go? What's the...
The hashtag is
I sound like a scholar.
I sound like a scholar. So we have kids from all over the university, from different places. So I said, you know, I'm Belton, I'm from Prospect, I sound like a scholar. And the idea is that your scholarship is not a function of your speech or dialect, and that we're all wonderful scholars, and you kids should be in that.
That's something, I want to add something real quick. Also, a lot of people, like, if they hear Megan or me or Belton or anybody talk from, like, around those areas, they get, I don't know, they don't say you're stupid, but they kind of act like you're a little bit stupid, and they don't recognize that it's not you just saying, like, stupid things. It's a pattern, kind of. It's not just random words coming out of your mouth. It's something that's actually, like, organized, and you grew up saying it, and so it's more than just that. It's not you just, it's not you just speaking broken language.
Yeah, that's an important focus, and actually one of the things to sort of end on a preachy note is that, you know, it's amazing that, you know, like every place else, North Carolina State has a sort of office of equality and diversity and so forth, and they talk about all kinds of diversity. But until we started the program and these students along with it, language was never included in diversity, so it's about gender, race, ethnicity, sex, you know, and stuff like that. But and to me, that's a real oversight, because language needs to be a part of that sort of recognition of diversity. So thanks so much for taking your time, you guys.
Oh, I'm sorry. I had a random question about Cherokee, actually. Do you guys still use, or do you use that syllabary at all?
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. Is it used in all three of the groups you're talking
about? Oh, yeah.
Do you teach it too in your classes?
Yeah, my students have a quiz every Friday for the first 6 or 7 weeks of class. We do one row during the first week of class, and then we do two rows every week after that.
One of the coolest things, and that's in the film a little, but it's certainly characteristic, is there's a Cherokee keyboard, and so you can text in Cherokee, you know, which uses all of the symbols, and there are 85 of them. Okay? And part of the thing there is, if you can't make language accessible to social media, you may as well forget it, because kids ain't gonna deal with it, and it's old-fashioned stuff.
One thing I would like to add about, like, something I've learned about recently, I guess, is, like, code switching. So we may talk like this when we're around other Lumbees or other people, but then you go somewhere else, like when you're talking with, I guess, people that aren't from there, you talk a different way. And so that's something like at Science and Math, I was told by some people that I had to learn how to do, is like change the way I talk in the different settings. So I don't know how I sound to you all, but like sometimes I feel like I don't sound like I'm from Prospect, but then if I talk to somebody, I do. And then people are like, just like, use your Lumbee dialect because they want to hear it. And I'm like, I can't just turn it on. I have to have somebody to talk to. So I don't know.
Because even when I go home now, everybody's like, you're losing your dialect. Like, you've been in Raleigh for 6 years. Like, and then people will appear to think I have it. But if you hear somebody that, like, straight out of Robeson County, they sound nothing like me. Theirs is just very, very, very thick. Like,
and people from home, like the elders, take it more of like you forgetting where you come from. And they think it's like an active process of you choosing to speak differently instead of it just happening, which like is what happens. So they think it's like you betraying, I guess, like who you are and stuff because you're embarrassed of it or something.
See, I have the opposite effect. When my sister, when she came up to state and everything, like we sounded like very urbanized and everything. When she came up to state, she started dating someone from the Lumbee tribe and everything, and she came home and she had the same accent as Megan and Belton, and my parents were like, what is up? And they're like, we sent you to Raleigh, you come back coming from like Pembroke and everything, and she goes, I can't help it. And so like she'll come home for a few weeks, and then she'll go back to her regular like dialect and accent and everything, go back to state. Boom, it's like she came back from like Lumberton or something. So we have the reverse.
Well, thanks so much. You guys were terrific. And Ben, thanks so much. I mean, you're a sort of inspiration in the eastern part of the state for all of us. And we're delighted that you're so close and excited about all the great work that you're doing and to have you around. And we're delighted to have you kids here. If there's anything we can do to help you, you also want to take a course in linguistics. Or in dialects, we have an undergraduate course in spoken and written dialects, and I've actually had some students who are creative writers who have written stories in Lumbee dialect and gotten them published. I'll have to share them with you. Yeah, it's kind of cool stuff. So thanks so much. Let's give them another round.